1519, where Montezuma sacrificed 80,000 people in 5 days. 80,000 people.
80,000 people.
Yeah. With no, like, and also think about the weaponry they used.
Like a butter knife.
Yeah. They're like, we're going to cut this tree and it's going to fall on five of you. Like, the crudest, you know what I mean?
They were doing it for the sun god? Something to do with the sun?
So Montezuma was doing this thing where he would take mushrooms, psilocybin mushrooms, and he would talk to the war god and ask him what he needs to do to be successful in the next war coming up. And the Aztecs of that time were such a fighting culture that all the other people that lived around him that weren't Aztec but different tribes and stuff, they would fight with them on a yearly basis but not wipe them out. Leave enough so these people can be strong enough to come back and fight next year.
Okay.
So they loved just letting everybody around pick up resources, slaughter them in the most violent ways you can think. And then that's the way the whole culture kind of pushed along until Cortez.
Okay, I'm drawing a very odd parallel to that story.
Tell me.
Have you seen Predators?
Yes, which one?
Okay, so Predators, we're talking the one with, when it was done by Rodriguez.
Okay.
Not a remake, it's like the most recent
sequel. I've
seen
so many Predators.
The one with, what's his name in it? Morpheus.
Yes, I've seen that one. Adrian Brody's Predator.
Yes. They were very angry at Lawrence Fishburne for not losing weight for that role.
Oh, really?
Because so for people who don't know, who haven't watched that movie, he lived on a planet that is essentially a hunting reserve for the predators.
Right.
And like just trying to get scraps to eat.
Do or die environment.
over the course of about like 10 years, like uncountable years. You don't know how long they've been there. And Lawrence Fishburne just shows up on set, just bloated.
Yeah.
Just he's not even like
overweight.
It's just true, actually. Fat. And they were so pissed, but he didn't want to lose weight and they had to like shoot it anyway.
So
that's that. But anyway, I like the concept of that movie because it was like, we're gonna bring all of the cool fighters into this planet. And then after we're going to hunt you. Yeah. Just so we can keep the skill up. And what was cool, that little piece of lore in the background, like I guess an Easter egg, is that they had like samurai swords. So they've been doing that since the age of samurais.
That's amazing. And they had really a Yakuza guy.
Yeah.
Yeah. They had like IDF, American military, Yakuza. Just a tatted up guy with a gun. Just like a pistol. Just like a handgun.
He was the first guy who decided to take his shoes off.
Hey man, that guy was badass.
He was.
Yeah.
He was. But you know who else is much more badass than that?
Tell me.
Genghis Khan.
Okay, tell me why.
Okay, I only know one good fact about this, so I'm going to say it. He killed 40 million people.
That's not a good fact.
Okay.
That's a terrible fact.
It's an incredible fact. Because your guy, the one that you brought to the table, was 80,000.
Which guy? Montezuma?
There you go.
Well, friggin' Montezuma was crazy. He was... Like I said, he was having mushrooms and deciding to sacrifice people.
Yeah, but the thing is weird is that I know most people, the people that I know that take mushrooms, they normally come out with very like positive life.
Yeah.
Like, hey man, I really need to be more compassionate. I need to like be less angry. Yeah. I need to do... This guy goes in there into the ether and he pulls 80,000 people killed with a brass
Yeah, which is like blunt things. So we had Fahad Malik talking about ayahuasca on the podcast, and he was telling me, he's like, everybody should do something like ayahuasca or mushrooms. The world would be a better place. So immediately, like, I have a good understanding of those substances, and I'm like, let me Google some stuff. And I came across, like, cultures that use psilocybin actively.
Mm-hmm.
When you go into a psilocybin ritual with the intention to talk to the war god, you're going to talk to the war god, dude. You're going to talk to the war god.
I see what you're saying.
You know what I mean?
I see what you're saying.
If you want to find some inner peace and calm and think about some issues, you might be able to do that. But you're like, I need to know how to win the next war. What do I need to do? You're going to kill 80,000 people in 5 days. 5 days. Were they running? You know?
At that point, you have to assume that their logistical planning on offing 80,000 people in that amount of time must have been amazing.
Probably pretty good.
Right? Like, I'm pretty sure today's corporations would learn a thing or two about the efficiency of the way how they killed people.
1519. It's not even that long ago. Even the Genghis Khan stuff. Oh, Genghis Khan's what? 1200s? Probably. We can get back to it.
Yeah, we can get back
What's
to it.
What's the next fact?
Between 1206. 1206 to 1227.
1206 to 1227.
That's when he was most active. He conquered 12 million square miles of territory.
Dang.
And like just on horse and
the hard way. That's as quick as you can go.
It's like not carpet bombing or anything like that. Just using that. He changed the world's temperature.
Dang.
He killed so many people that where like the people would die. You couldn't plant anything there. It was like a biological nightmare of just like fat that seeped into the soil.
Dang. They used to also, when it got too cold, they would just, whatever horse they were riding, they would kill the horse, eat it, and move on. Like, just, now someone's getting a piggyback. And they would carry horses with them, those spares.
Yeah.
Because these things can move, but they're also food and they're massive.
Right, right.
Most cultures, when it comes to the Europeans or the Arabics, like they were very protective of their rides. They're like, I'm going to eat you.
I feel like when you've conquered 12 million square miles, you have a bunch of spare horses. Something that's cool that I don't think some people might not know is so they were very adept archery men. But they would do it from the back of a horse.
Okay.
As opposed to, you know how normally you see them in ranks, like on the ground, aim and then fire or whatever?
Yeah.
They were doing it from the back of a horse.
Right.
And normally you had to hold on to a horse to ride it.
Yeah.
So they were so good at riding a horse that they would just ride it with their legs would clamp onto the horse. And then, you know, when they gallop, there's a kind of like a part where you're a little bit in midair and then you come back down again. That's when they would let go of the arrow. So they would pull. Yeah. And when they like pop up, let go of the arrow. It's like when you hold your breath to shoot a sniper rifle.
Drive-by experts over here. That's what that is. That's a drive-by expert. Like, get it on the bounce. Gotta get on the bounce.
Oh, man.
Have you seen the bows and arrows that they use?
It's probably longbows, right?
Dude, it's just like, how do you kill anybody with this kind of stuff? It's not long bows because you have to like have it on a horse, you know?
Yeah.
So it's like a... Like, how do they aim at anything? It's the equivalent of a musket, but they were really good with this kind of stuff because that's what you needed to eat.
Like, right.
You're trying to kill ram and birds and stuff.
So. Okay, so it's not a recurve, right? It was just a straight bow.
It's like it's not as good as a, you can call it a recurve. I think that's the closest thing to call it.
Oh, okay.
Because a longbow is much bigger and you need like a lot of space to make it work. The Japanese are really big on that. Yeah. Horse riding bows are just different.
Oh, I see.
Also, these people were vicious. Like, that's the thing that, like, I know you were looking at some websites right now. Like, these people were crazy. The guy killed his brother when he was 10 over, like, hunting spoils. He killed his brother when he was 10.
Yeah. How old was his brother?
You know what? That's a really good question. Because I'm like, how does a 10-year-old kill anybody?
Right.
It's probably 2. I don't know. Well, I'm assuming. I have no idea.
I'm assuming as well. I think I can confirm that one real quick. But the other thing that I liked about
man, you're saying what you're saying.
He was tolerant to all religions because he didn't want to roll the dice and die.
Right.
And he figured he followed the wrong religion, so he was on board with everything just in case one of them is true.
Pretty jokes.
Apparently that was his mental thing.
You know what? Even a guy that evil,
yeah,
he's like, you know what? Any one of these could be true. I'm gonna kill all these people, but I'm gonna be nice to these people following their religion. That's interesting, isn't it?
I think so.
That's so weird.
Which means, I mean, like, they had like very strong belief in some sort of afterlife.
Yeah.
But that does seem oddly progressive of him.
Kinda. But they're like, hey, Genghis, everything you do is wrong according to all these religions. You gotta stop.
So what was interesting about the fact that he was tolerant is that he also learned about all the religions.
Yeah.
Right? And so what that allowed him to do was when he was fighting specific religions, he would use his knowledge of that particular religion to taunt or harass those people.
Okay.
So for example.
Yeah.
You're cupping the mic. It's gonna.
Sure.
For example, if he was attacking Muslims.
Yeah.
Right. He would say that God sent me as a punishment for you, which is interesting why he would decide to say that. Mm-hmm. Like, so he's saying that this is an inevitability. I was sent by God for me to test you, and I'm going to.
Oh man, where did you read this?
Most of my information with regards to him is a podcast called Hardcore History.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's the Wrath of the Khans. I think you have to pay for it now. It was free back then, but now
it sucks. Well, I mean, just watch Marco Polo.
Have you watched it?
Yeah.
The whole thing?
Yeah. It's not that long.
Okay. How was it?
It's pretty good. It's one of the most expensive things Netflix ever has made. I think it's the most expensive show Netflix has ever made.
Because of like set design and stuff.
It's on the scale of a Game of Thrones. Mm. So like a lot of shooting on site. Tons of costumes and like epic scenes. Mm-hmm. So it's just like that. And it's a period piece also. So like there's nothing you can kind of reuse. Like, oh, this building's already here. Right. We'll just, you know, go in the diner. Yeah. No. Like,
so was it good though?
It's pretty, yeah, it's good. Mm. And everybody,
I tried watching the first couple episodes. I couldn't get into it.
I don't know anybody who's like watched the first season and doesn't like it. Oh. So I only know like 6-7 people. Historically, I'm not saying it's the most accurate thing, but it's, you know how it ends. With that said, it's a good ride. Like, it's a good ride. I'd recommend it. They go very deep into like what kind of harems these guys used to keep of women, and some of them were assassins, and they were like professionals at pleasuring people.
Okay, I you said harems, and I said as a clarifier.
Yep,
of women. So like, what else? I guess men.
Yeah. Well, could be. Yeah. It's like 6 women, 2 guys, and a goat. And you don't know what the goat does, and the goat's like the best one.
I remember that scene in 300.
Yeah, wow.
Where it was showing all the ladies, you're like, oh, yes, yes. And then it was a goat.
Yep. You think the Persians got mad at that part? The Persians are like, hey, man, where are you looking? And what do you mean? Can't defend the goat thing. Everything else, they were like, it was a terrible time. You know, hard times, rough people. Like, this is what the goat, like, hey, man, we don't need to talk about the goat.
I mean, if it happens now, it happened then.
The goat thing?
Yeah.
You think people are still like doing it with goats? What do you mean?
Yeah, I think so. I think there's no limit to the depravity of humans. Mm. Enough boredom.
That's true.
Enough with the population. The bigger the population, the crazier the people you'll get.
State like Alabama. I mean, I can't put shit past them.
Okay. Speaking about a population and the crazy people we get.
Yeah.
So me and Syed, we went to see.
Oh, man. That's a beautiful segue, by the way. Because yeah. Go ahead.
We went to see the weigh-ins for UFC 204.
Right.
No, 206.
206. Yesterday, beautiful Toronto, Canada.
Yep. And so, so for you to get the weigh-ins are free, so you can just show up. It's on Friday. It starts at about like 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock or whatnot. And what's cool is that you just walk into any entrance of the ACC, and you walk through the metal detector. They check you out a little bit, and then, all right, go in and sit down wherever you
want
to sit.
Wherever you want, anywhere you want to sit down. There'll be a crazy person there. Sit with them.
And all the vendors are up and they're selling food. It's really great. Okay, there wasn't that many people there, but. So for those of you who don't know, before the weigh-ins, what will happen is that they have like an interview where they'll have a couple fighters come in, ask some questions to get a Q&A session. Mm-hmm. So then people line up in front of like 2 sets of mics and they ask a question. So this is your opportunity to talk to, you know, some of the most elite fighters.
Right.
And get in their head, find out, like, you know, ask them a cool question.
On stage at the Air Canada Center.
Yep.
These people flew here from places and they were like world champions, and you got Mike Goldberg's going out to the internet. Yeah. People are watching this to get information.
Yes. Yes. So this is it, right? So you would think that everyone that's there is an Uber fan, because if you know you'd have to take time off work or get out of school or whatever for you to be able to
like
show up.
2 p.m.
So you would think that the quality of questions you would get would be somewhat interesting. I have to say, it felt like we saw the absolute worst of Toronto.
You realize what kind of caliber of person has free time enough to come out in the middle of the day, and what subsection of those people are willing to get up and ask questions? That was because there were normal people like us.
Who sat down?
We just sat down. We're like, yeah, we want to see what they want to say.
Yeah.
What do the fighters want to say? And then people come up and they just start yelling at the fighter. If your cardio was better, bro, I would be a fan of yours. Like just yelling and cursing at them. And I'm like, this fighter, we've seen what he can do.
He hit someone so hard, his tooth flew out of his mouth upwards.
Mm-hmm.
His body landed on the ground and then the tooth came back down. That's how hard he hit that guy.
A part of this person's memory has been erased forever. Something happened to them. They have no recollection of it, except they don't have a tooth now. That's their reality.
And there's some guy who's saying...
This guy who came here because he saw this man hit a guy in the tooth so hard it fell out, erases memory, comes in front of this guy and goes, hey man, I'm not a fan. Your cardio's bad. And just yelling at him. And the whole time I'm like, dude, you know when you see like an animal? I'm like, this guy, if he wanted, he could jump over everything. There's nothing here stopping him from like killing you.
It's like five to 10 paces away.
Yeah. And the whole time we're like, does he know he's not on the internet? Like he's face to face. He thinks he's on the internet.
It was very cringeworthy. There was a number of questions. There was one guy who went and asked a question. First of all, the first question wasn't even a question. No. Well, I guess it was. It was a request. The request was, hey, can I get a selfie with you? And can you find Joe Rogan so we can take a picture together? And then they're like, I guess we could.
Turned to Yasin and he said, I already regret coming. You're like, what is this shit?
There was one guy who asked a question.
Yeah.
It was a shit question.
Mm-hmm.
He sat down and then he sent his mom up to ask another question.
Hey, man. I had another question. Who am I going to have ask it? Thanks, mom.
At that point, I feel like it's our responsibility to show up and ask a question. So it'd be like, listen, we're not all retarded.
Yeah. Just declare, I don't have a question. Just want to say something.
You know?
There was one guy with the gold chain and he looked like he was on drugs. Like he was an older gentleman on the right side.
Yeah, yeah,
he was just swaying back and forth while asking the question.
He would lean in. He would ask a question, then take two steps back.
Yeah. I was just like, oh man, that guy's not right.
And then Rumble Johnson actually told him, "Stay no to drugs. Say no to drugs."
Yeah.
I can't believe they were so. Some of them were actually pretty rude to the fighter, and like, I don't know if they even see his hands. You pointed out Rumble Johnson's hand, and first of all, his hands gigantic.
Yeah.
And then like on each knuckle is like it's darker.
Yeah, it's a different like layers of calluses to make his hand like a mitt. Like a glove instead of a hand.
Yeah.
It's just a skin glove wrapped around a hand that he punches things with.
He punches you with three rocks or two rocks.
But it was still a good time, man.
Yeah, apart from that, that was fun. And then after the question and answer period, you noticed that they were allowing people to come sit closer. So that was cool. So we got to sit really close to one of our, like, I think it's safe to say, idols.
Yeah, I guess.
One of our idols.
One of the most influential people.
Yeah, Joe Rogan.
Yeah, and the guy was... I don't know what you see the man on TV, right?
Yep.
And you know he's in good shape. You see the Instagram videos, he's just throwing like 90-pound kettlebells around. But like when you see him in person, I felt like reality added 20 pounds of muscle. You know what I mean? He's just wider and like bigger than life, even though he's my height. He's like he's not a tall guy.
Yeah.
But all of a sudden, I was like, Joe Rogan is a powerful person to be in front of.
Yeah, he's like a gorilla.
Yeah.
He's short, stocky, and his arms was bursting out of that t-shirt.
Right?
And you know what? There was something weird about, I don't think I idolize a lot of people that much. Like, you know, I love Childish Gambino.
Mm-hmm.
So seeing him live, I'm pretty sure would give me a similar type of reaction.
Right.
But for the most part, I'm okay with just, you know, I'll listen to their music or I'll enjoy their art by watching like a movie or something.
Yeah.
I'm good. I'm not gonna. But for Joe, it's like I spent... Well, how many episodes are we on the podcast now? It's like 800 and something, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, plus 1,000 hours.
Wow. Yeah.
Listening to him. And
and watch him learn.
Yeah. Like, that's true. His own opinion's changing as and you start understanding, you start appreciating kind of like, you know, the inquisitiveness of how he approaches issues or like questions that needs to be asked, you know, to clarify something. But, you know. The thing is like a lot of times someone will say something, and you're like, wow, really?
Mm-hmm.
And then you just kind of roll with it.
Yeah.
Whereas he will be like, wait, no, hold on. what about this? Let's also think about this other thing. And I don't know. I think a lot of that had an effect on me.
No, it should, man.
So when you see him, mm-hmm. it's like, that's what I get it.
Yeah.
There he is, larger than life. And he's doing his thing.
Right in front of Brittany and Ariane. What did you think about Brittany and Ariane? If anybody doesn't know, those are the ring girls, longtime ring girls for the UFC. And Yasin has an opinion. I don't know if he has an opinion. I'm kind of putting him on the spot. I'm sure he has a opinion.
Right. The most easiest of the opinions is mm-hmm. the fact that they're incredibly pretty ladies.
Very beautiful.
But there's something to be that I appreciate more mm-hmm. is that UFC doesn't cycle through.
Yeah.
They like these ladies have been doing this for a while.
Yeah.
And there's something I'm good with that.
This is what the UFC does. They'll have two.
Yeah.
They'll throw in, and they did this yesterday. They'll throw in a third, like, to hold up the cards. Mm-hmm. And if that person somehow with their beauty is able to beat the one of the Ariane or Brittany, they will drop Ariane or Brittany as soon as the next big star comes up. That's the way
to
Brittany,
do the walk around?
Yeah, that's how Brittany got her job. Ariane had a different teammate. You don't know about this. Ariane's been doing this for like 8 years.
Okay.
That's impressive on its own. Mm-hmm. If your only job is to look good and look the same and you're fighting time mm-hmm. and you're able to do it for 8 years, God bless you. I don't know what goat blood you drink or what you had to do to get there, but good for you.
Right.
She had a black lady at one point, Chandra, mm-hmm. who got let go because she did some softcore porn.
Mm-hmm.
Then she had a girl named Amber, mm-hmm. who had a messed up finger. So whenever she'd wave, her one finger would be bent. So she would wave and it'd be really funny. And then Brittany came around with all of her fingers and now she's been here for 5 years. But there were some like long stand, like 3 year, 10 year.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And next girl comes around and that's what it is right now. Ariane, Brittany, they're recognizable. They're mm-hmm. interesting. I don't know if they're interesting. But they're steady. They look the same every time.
I feel like it would be cool if like, I don't know if they have an interest in fighting or whatnot, mm-hmm. but like if they get to branch out and do some other stuff.
Mm.
But they already have Olivia, what's her name? She's really good.
Oh, yeah.
She's one of the lady interviewers.
I wouldn't Brittany or Ariane interview somebody.
Yeah.
I don't think. I've seen Ariane speak because she's gone out with a few fighters. She's mm-hmm. gone out with Diego Sanchez, I mm-hmm. believe, and Roger Huerta.
Uh-huh.
And it doesn't seem like the brightest bulb,
but a
very nice bulb to look at.
Yep.
Brittany, on the other hand, I've seen some of her paintings.
Mm.
And she has like some Bruce Lee paintings and stuff, and they were pretty good.
Okay.
That's all I know about them.
I feel like you need to see, the thing is that if you're number one,
yeah.
is a time dependent type thing.
All right.
You should like take the opportunity to build up a second thing.
Whatever. Cushion company, supplements.
Right.
They both probably have like workout videos on, like, they probably have a very active Instagram account of them squatting and then unsquatting and then squatting again. People follow, like,
dude, of course. Of course they do.
I know friends are like, yeah, I follow this person, that person.
I mean, I follow a couple. I just don't follow those two.
Yeah, but people follow them. Millions of them. It's really funny. Something for everybody.
I guess so.
But I will say this. Seeing them there made the show. Like, it was cool. I got to see Joe. I got to see Mike. I got to see Dana and them too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's funny. I didn't even notice Dana until like a little while after.
You were like fourth weigh-in person in, you're like, there's Dana. I'm like, yeah, he came out, everybody.
that was an interesting thing. But we didn't watch we didn't actually go watch the fights.
No.
To our, am I using this word properly? Chagrin?
Chagrin? Everybody, when they say to our, they're going to say chagrin, most likely.
True. I was very chagrined that we didn't go watch it.
We went to a friend's birthday party instead.
I mean, yeah.
What do you mean? She's expecting a baby.
I don't regret going to the birthday party.
Okay.
I regret not going to the fight.
Right. We had tickets to the fight, which I moved the day before for about the same price as I bought them for instead of going. And then once we saw the fights, Yasin called me. He's like, dude, it would have been good to go. And I was thinking that like 5 minutes prior. I was like, oh, this moment, that moment. Because card, I know, didn't have all the names, but so many good moments for this fight card.
We'll start with the biggest moment of that card.
You go. You tell me, because I have two.
Okay, fight of the year.
All right, we have the same moment.
Cub Swanson.
Yep.
Fighting Do Ho Choi.
Do Ho.
I believe I'm getting his name right.
The Korean Superboy. You got it right. You got it right. Trust me.
First of all, what's amazing, first of all, is the fact that Do Ho Choi, yeah, who comes from South Korea.
Imagine somebody coming, like a young guy from South Korea, and that's him.
Okay. So when you were a kid and you walked into Kumon, mm-hmm, trying to get that math grade up, and there was a tutor,
yeah,
and there was a guy who was helping the tutor. And that guy helping the tutor, that's the guy who was fighting in the ring.
Yeah.
It was an unassuming math tutor who did not look cut
super
or built.
Clean cut. Just
doesn't look like he can generate the amount of power that he generates out of like his right
guy.
Punch. Just, yeah. And they fought.
They fought. Like, yeah, they fought technically, but these two guys fought. This is what a fight should look like.
Oh my God, they went to war. It was freaking insanity.
And both guys, like, ooh, here's my momentum. I'm going to hit you a few times. I'm thinking the fight's almost over. And the other guy comes back and is back and forth.
Yeah.
And you could tell, like, there's no quit in these guys. There's no quit in these men.
Yeah.
And that's what made it so exciting. I was like, you're going to have to kill a man to put him out right here.
Yeah.
Right?
You'll have to turn him off.
Yeah.
You'll have to shut his lights out.
He's not going
to
take a knee. He would have taken a knee.
Yeah.
Like another fight we'll get into later on, you get hit in the head, you get in the body a few times. At some point, you're like, this just isn't, I'm just going to take a knee.
Right.
It's not worth it.
Yeah.
These guys are like, no. Like, no. You're going to have to kill me.
Yeah. Two fighters with, like, keep saying this incredible heart.
Yeah.
That was that. They just, all the way till the end, it was not a single boring moment. They threw bones at each other the entire time. Yeah. One, a super technical fighter. The other one, it's not like he was less technical. It's just like, you know, the punches, instead of coming straight, were coming from around the corner.
Especially when Choi's been rocked a few times and he's still fighting technically, that's what I'm like, that's weird. You don't know how to fight any other way. Like, this is how you know how to fight. Everything is tight.
Yeah. He never learned the wrong way.
Yeah.
Because for him to, his degrading in quality is the same.
Yeah, that was...
It's the same. It's amazing.
I don't know, man.
Because there's a lot of, like, survival mode...
Yeah.
Instances in that fight where it's like you just need to do what your subconscious is telling you to do. You're not doing any problem solving. And even then he was just fighting the same way that he
I was impressed. He was collected. He took anybody who hears me talk about fighting, I love fighting. I can't watch guys like that hit each other in the head for 25 minutes or even 15 minutes. I can't. Like, it's hard for me. Yeah. As much as I love the sport, like, at some point, this sport's going to need to die.
Yeah.
Like football or something. Like, that's way too much. Those guys aren't going to be there. I'm like, we pay money to see them, but when that Do Ho Choi, when he hits 60, dude, he's not going to be able to do any math. It's probably his favorite thing.
I mean, they're both walking out of that place with, like, severe migraines, severe neck pains, severe, like, might be, like, double vision type situations happening.
Life-changing stuff that, like, manifests itself 20 years after the fact.
Mm-hmm. But that's the appreciation.
Yeah, that's why we cheer so much. Or like,
that's when because the entire ACC was on their feet for that fight.
They were chanting Do Ho Choi. You know how hard it is to chant Do Ho Choi? Like... For a whole, like, 20,000 people, Do Ho Choi?
Yeah.
It's amazing.
And he has no ties to Canada. This is the first time he's been here.
Yeah.
Right?
And Cub's been fighting for 10 years, 40 fights.
Yeah.
Fan favorite. But people know. Brendan Schaub was talking about this on his podcast, saying, like, people say Vegas is the center of MMA. Mm. It's Toronto. He's like, Toronto is the capital of MMA.
Mm. Why?
It's arguable. Simply, well, one of the ways it was judged earlier was that when there were no shows in Canada, pay-per-view buys for a country, Canada per capita was way higher than any other place in the world.
Mm-hmm.
So, and even when it came to cities, the top cities to buy pay-per-views were Vegas, Toronto, BC, Montreal. Like, in the top 10, there were three to four Canadian cities. Yeah. So it was already known that Canada had a big appetite for whatever reason. I really don't know. But when they had their first fight in Toronto, they realized that they broke all sorts of, not just Toronto records, but how quickly they can sell tickets, how quickly they can get to, you know, 200 pay-per-views bought and stuff like that. So just a rabid fan base, but also per capita, the most gyms. When you go to Toronto, there's just a ton of jiu-jitsu places, Muay Thai places, wrestling places.
Mm-hmm.
like just under buildings in like just random places. And a lot of great talent from around the world comes here to train and set up facilities.
Yeah, that's interesting. And we do have TriStar as well, which is and with Faraz Zahabi.
Yep.
Who's like super respected in the MMA circles.
We lucked out as a country because we got one of the greatest talents in MMA history, like George St. Pierre, who was friends with Faraz Zahabi, who was a very talented coach. And these two connected like to each other's success at a very early age, and it pushed both of them forward. Mm-hmm. Faraz coaching and his ability to get other really good coaches on board, like Phil Nurse and other people, was ridiculous. And he brought in talent from out west, you know, Rory McDonald, mm-hmm. with a young guy and a teenager, brought him in. Yeah. And at that point, they decided that no matter what happens, Rory can't fight GSP. They got Jordan Mee and all these people, and their star rose. And I love it. I love how big MMA is in Canada. Mm-hmm. I just wish it was less. There was some way that these people weren't like, because we're young right now, but when we get to be, let's say, 40, we're going to see these people and we're like, look how he's talking.
Yeah.
And it's going to be sad. Yeah. We're going to see like.
You're going to see some punch drunk people for sure.
You're going to see, you know, Robbie Lawler speak. You're going to see Tyron Woodley, these guys, the people that you loved, and what you loved them for is what gets them to be where they are. I don't know what other lines of work are quite like that.
I feel like also there'd be a thing about, you know, when to quit. Some people that don't take that much punishment to their head.
Yeah.
So
you can't let.
You can get out because of different people. Like Cub Swanson will take two for him to be able to, mm-hmm. to put two.
Yeah.
That by the way, just at the end of that fight where you think things might slow down a little bit, he was doing Superman punches. Mm-hmm. He was doing cartwheel kicks.
Yeah. He was doing ridiculous stuff, man.
So
he was
crazy.
Honestly, it's I don't think that guy's meant to do anything else.
Yeah. I think, yeah, exactly. I was going to say that. I was talking to, I forgot who I was talking to. If we didn't have the UFC and, you know, no military or whatever.
Right.
Where do these people go?
Well, where do any of the, where does, if you take football players, like, and you visualize, you know, from quarterback to these linebackers, basketball players like LeBron and everybody of that, and hockey players.
Yeah.
If these sports didn't exist and the military didn't exist, they'd just be out and about.
Yeah, just doing shit.
And
the stuff
that
they were doing.
Just being bigger than everybody else, you know?
That's why football was invented.
Yeah.
American football was invented because there was the war was over.
Yeah.
And they needed to figure out a way for men in general to focus their aggression.
Yeah.
And enter American football.
Yeah. And that's why it's such a so much more physical sport than anything else that was big at the time, other than actually boxing, which you can't just put all of them in there. It's too many of them.
That being said, still, American football, as far as a physical sport is concerned, is freaking nasty.
It is.
It's crazy demanding.
For a sport that pretends to have other motives, you know, other than hurting people. Like, from that perspective, like, there are more physically more destructive sports. I'm like, they don't pretend to have a ball and have another, like, here's my strategy. We have all these eight coaches lined up with pads, you know?
It's essentially war without guns.
Yeah. And this guy, my city, and football has that where it's just like, other cities don't like each other, but football, they have like proper rivalries.
Yeah.
Long term.
Yeah.
I don't know. Soccer, I can't, like, I know there's a lot of like fans that get into the hooliganism.
Yeah.
And it's awesome to watch those documentaries if you've ever done it.
You told me to watch Green Street Hooligans.
Green Street Hooligans with homeboy Elijah Wood.
Which
and
was an odd thing to see him in.
Oh yeah. And Sons of Anarchy, Jackson.
Oh, he was in it?
Yeah, he's the main character with Elijah Wood.
Oh,
yeah. He's the hooligan, and he's trying to watch out for Elijah, who's trying to come in. Mm-hmm. Watch the movie. Anybody listening won't be disappointed.
Yeah.
Green Street Hooligans.
Free on YouTube.
Oh, it's free on YouTube. Yes, it is. You're right. But I'm like, those hooligans are crazy. But what's happening on the field is fairly...
Yeah.
It pales in comparison to anything really violent.
Yeah.
People
flicking ears and they're falling down going,
I don't want to give them a bad name because that's, I know that stuff happens, but just the sport itself is just, there's not a lot of contact, you know, but like football,
it's all contact.
That's what you're hoping to see.
Yes.
That's what I want to see.
Yep.
I want to see somebody get laid out and somebody like, You know how they like crump dance on top of you after putting you out, or is just like so much happening all of a sudden?
There's so many cool ones. Yeah. There's one after he does whatever it is that he does. Mm-hmm. He takes his samurai sword,
right,
and like pulls it out. Like he's doing like a cutting motion, and then he puts it back in.
See, you weren't. I don't know how much football you were watching in the like late '90s.
No.
What was happening is after every touchdown, the celebrations got so elaborate that they made rules. And now you can't do like an elaborate celebration. But they used to be like well-rehearsed, like seven guys involved. Like it's a full play. Like it would be so much fun to watch. And the NFL right now is going through a tough time. It's just like not as fun to watch. I feel like, man, I got to let these personalities out.
Yeah.
Be more like MMA. Like that's what MMA, it's all personality. Look at Conor McGregor.
Oh my God.
That's what we're buying. We buy the personality.
Conor, what do you think about that? These big Irish balls in your face.
Yeah.
Like, I don't get it, but everyone's
cheering.
Yeah,
I like it. I don't know. I don't like it, but it's provocative.
He shows up dancing in a mink fur coat. That was before.
I love it. And now what? Now what's he gonna? Is he gonna have a mink with him?
He freaking won. Anyway, we didn't finish off UFC 206. So it's our next favorite.
Yes.
Donald Cerrone and Brown.
Yeah, Matt Brown, the immortal. That was a great fight. That was exactly what you imagined it would be. I felt like the Choi Cub fight was like a best case scenario that happened. But like this is what I expected to happen, and it played out beautifully.
Okay.
And it was back and forth fight, whatever. The finish was what really punctuated this fight for me. Where I don't know for you, but did you get loud or did you get quiet?
I got quiet.
I got quiet
because look, when someone's getting hit and they're slowly moving back, you're like right, and they're like sinking down, right? Yeah. But when someone gets hit and they just go,
yeah. So Cowboy threw just a beautiful switch kick with his left foot, and it landed cleanly.
Can you explain a switch kick first?
Yeah, so a switch kick is you have your conventional standing style. So for a conventional right-handed person, your right fist is back, your left hand is in front of you, your left foot is in front of you, your right leg is back. And that's the conventional way of actually fighting. And
which is called orthodox.
Orthodox. Mm-hmm. And the other one is southpaw, mm-hmm. which is if you're a lefty. Mm-hmm. A switch kick is if you are standing in your conventional style, left foot forward, right foot back, and you decide, and you, not everybody does this, but you have to have really good dexterity with your left foot to be able to throw an off kick. So you're actually moving forward and throwing a kick with your non-dominant leg. Mm-hmm. So it's harder to see. Mm-hmm. And you don't expect as much because all the offense, the power shots do come from the other side of the human body.
Right.
So if you're good at disguising something like this or throwing it after a jab, it's when it does land, it doesn't stun you. If you want to see somebody get knocked out, what you want to do is see anybody get hit with a punch or a kick that they didn't see coming.
Yeah.
It's not about the power. It is definitely about the accuracy. But when you don't brace your body for a shot, you think you're out of danger. That's when your body is not ready to get. And we saw it. We saw the perfect example of Matt Thomas Brown getting hit in the head in a way where he was out midair.
Yeah.
Like before his body hit the floor,
yeah.
Cerrone was turning around and walking the other way.
Yeah.
And Joe's reaction was silence.
Yeah.
And homeboy was like, and it is. And Joe was like, shit.
And it's all over.
That was shocking.
There was another highlight in that fight.
Yeah.
Okay. All throughout the embedded.
Yep.
We were getting an idea that Donald Cerrone and Matt Brown used to train together. Mm-hmm. And they were friends.
Yeah.
But Matt Brown was saying like, yo, we used to train together, but that doesn't mean that we were friends. Mm-hmm. And Donald was like, yeah, we were friends. We were friends, dude. We used to be friends.
The way right? Donald was trying to shake his hand.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, the way, no. And he's like, hey, no. you want me to give me a shake? And then he just wouldn't do it. Anyway. So that's been going on throughout sort of like the pre-fight segment of UFC 206. Yeah. Then when they get into the octagon, mm-hmm. where you can touch gloves if you want to and then start, they don't do that either.
Yeah.
And I feel like Donald Cerrone is like, all right, well, we're just gonna have to fight. Mm-hmm. So they fought two rounds.
Yeah.
And they were on their third round.
Tooth and nail fighting.
Like hard.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then Donald Cerrone, ever the friendly guy, yeah. He's like, hey, you want to touch gloves this time?
He's like, come on.
You want to touch gloves this time? You want to go? Right? And then they do that. And then Donald Cerrone puts his hands up. He's like, yeah.
Right? I think that was a moral victory. I think that played a part in the fight.
Yeah. Because Joe Rogan's like, I think that's a victory of friendship right there. Mm-hmm. I was so happy. For some reason, I was so happy that his friend gave him a high five, you know, finally. Because he's been asking for it for so long.
I saw that too. And as soon as I saw that, I thought Matt Thomas Brown's going to lose. As soon as I saw that, I'm like, wait, you're supposed to be a come forward aggressive fighter. Mm-hmm. That happened and he didn't come forward for a good 10 seconds.
Yeah, that might have ended it.
I just know, I thought it broke his concentration a little bit because he has to fight a very specific fight to beat Donald Cerrone, who's better than him.
Yeah.
And I felt like he was just like, Donald did the right thing. He's like, yes. And then he kicked him in the head and put him out.
The thing is that I don't think Donald was being malicious. He really wanted to high five his friend.
Yeah.
that's the way how I'm reading it. Nah. I was so happy, like, aw, that's nice, dude. Yeah. You got your high five from your friend. And then you... kick him in the head. And then you turned him off.
He would be if I had somebody who wanted to watch the UFC for the first time, I would purposely aim for Donald Cerrone fights. Yeah. It's just a great example of MMA. Yeah. Right?
Such a gent. Thanks his grandmother. Go ahead.
The main event was pretty good. It was Max Holloway defeating Anthony Pettis. Pettis broke his hand, so it was kind of anticlimactic because you kind of saw it coming.
Mm-hmm.
But Max Holloway from Hawaii, new interim lightweight champion, I guess.
Yep. Until they figure out what they're going to do with that division.
Until they figure out. I got to see Anthony Pettis' coach at my local convenience store. The day of the weigh-ins, I was buying milk. And I was like, are you Duke Rufus? And he was like, yeah. And I was like, are you buying avocados? He's like, yeah. I was like, can I take a picture? He's like, sure. And then he was buying avocados for Anthony Pettis.
All right, folks. We want to pause for a moment and think about this. Most people know fighters. If they're a fan of UFC, they know fighters. Syed knows their trainers.
I know their trainers. What? That's how you know? Here, man. That's how you know you're a fan.
Yeah, for damn sure. I was proud of you getting that picture. Yeah. That was amazing. Also, I'm pretty sure Duke Rufus was like...
Oh, yeah. He's like...
One for me. He didn't even ask me about... Yeah. Who is he training? Sorry.
Anthony Pettis.
Yeah, he didn't even ask me about Anthony Pettis.
No. I'm a big fan. I'm a big fan of coaches, man. I'm a big fan of coaches for any sport. I think the skill of coaching is so important. I think it's more important than having a fighter that has all the talent in the world.
Yeah.
Is having a coach that can figure out what to do with them. Mm-hmm. Like even as a person, like you've had teachers in the past.
Yeah.
You know what it's like when you have somebody who knows what they're doing.
Yeah.
We don't generally run into them in school per se. I mean, sometimes you have like master teachers in school, but like even with my like tennis coach or jujitsu or whatnot, you just know like, man, this person has a great way of explaining things.
Yeah.
And yeah, Duke Rufus, I would love to say like, yeah, but like, you know, Anthony Pettis got lost and stuff. So it's sad.
That was sad.
He'll be back. He'll be back at 155.
Yeah, it was good. It's good that he acknowledges that the cut's too hard.
Yeah.
And then do some recalibration. You're talking about coaches?
Yeah.
I can't hear the word coach without having to refer this show. Friday Night Lights. You never got around to watch it, I know.
I saw the movie twice.
No. I mean talking about the show.
I know. I didn't watch the show.
Okay. It's fine.
You can tell he's annoyed. It's fine. It's okay.
That show is centered upon the coach and his wife. Yeah, and it's so damn good, Syed. Mm. It's so damn good.
And it's just one season?
No, unfortunately, there is four.
No, that's not unfortunate.
But, I mean...
Genghis Khan stuff you were excited about earlier was unfortunate. Like, it's something I'm excited about. Killed 40 million people. Changed the climate. And I'm like, no, it's unfortunate.
The guy who acts, because he's Charles Chandler. No, Kyle Chandler,
right?
Who's from Bloodline.
Bloodlines, not True Blood.
Bloodline, which both seasons were really good, by the way.
Yeah, I saw those. I saw that show.
Yeah.
Great show.
He's an amazing coach, dude.
Yeah.
Like, it's that show is a very special show. It's one of those, you know what it is? You know what it's good for?
What?
I'll tell you exactly what it's good for. This winter, when it snows a lot and you have to stay home inside in the warmth.
Okay.
Right? You put on Netflix, you find yourself Friday Night Lights.
It's on Netflix?
Yeah.
All right, man.
Yeah. It's one of those stay at home, be cozy, let's watch this and feel some feels. It's so good.
Okay.
Right? He's like molding men.
I see you.
And he does a really good job at it. And he like, you know, it's a poorer section of I believe Texas.
Right. Yeah, it's definitely Texas.
Yeah. Poor section of that. And he has to sort of like manage, you know, like white people. So poor white people, and then he also has to figure out how to relate to black kids as well.
Yeah, and Texas, that's where you make poor white people.
Exactly,
that's where they're from.
But like it was cool because like he would change his approach depending on the kid and his background and stuff. So like you know some kids that would come like from prison, and this was their like third strike. Like this is it. If they don't do it, they're going to jail for a long time type of thing. Repeat offenders. There's also like just regular kids that were nerds.
Right.
And the way how he like molds all of these people to make some type of team, some type of high school team, is of note. Like it's super interesting.
You know what? I know I'll get to it at some point. I feel bad now because you've told me for so long to watch this show.
Like a few years.
That when I do watch it, I just feel like you'll say like finally. And then you won't even talk to me about it.
No. I'm definitely going to talk to you about it. I'm definitely going to talk to you about it. I had a friend. I was trying to get her to watch Firefly. And it took her like 5 years.
It's hard to make girls watch Firefly sometimes.
Yeah, but...
I find it harder to make ladies watch Firefly or anything sci-fi than guys. Because a guy will just pick up a sci-fi show and run with it.
Uh-huh.
Where most of my friends that are girls, even if I suggest a show to them and that they do watch, they generally don't go to my sci-fi like suggestions just because they're like, Doctor Who?
Yeah, but
like,
she was a nerd.
Well, then you got the right girl. So you found a nerd girl.
Yeah. I mean, she's a friend. But what I mean to say is that, like, it was in the wheelhouse, right? I'm not taking someone that watches Vampire Diaries and say, you really need to get on this Battlestar Galactica.
Have you seen Vampire Diaries?
I believe I've seen one episode.
It's good soundtrack. I'm just saying. So you shouldn't judge people when you say things, Yasin.
I'm going to go ahead and judge it. You know why I'm going to go ahead and judge that shit show?
I was going out with a girl trying to get on the same show. I wasn't trying to watch Vampire Diaries. I saw 6 episodes, though.
Okay.
Sorry. I was like, before Yasin tells me about who I am, I was like, this is what I was trying to do. It was getting serious. Enough. I had to watch your show.
Okay. All right. Fair enough.
You know how it is.
We've all done that.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know what? Okay, let me tell you a dirty secret.
Okay.
Let me tell you a dirty secret.
Better be dirty. If it's a clean secret, I'm going to be mad. I'm going to be so disappointed. I'm going to ask you to dirty it up later. I'm like, dirty this.
Okay. I may have set myself up to fail now. But
okay.
You would think that my interest in F1 race, like F1 racing, F1 cars.
Interesting.
Is as a result of the fact that I'm a car guy and I really love cars. So you would think then that what it is.
Oh.
Initially, what got me into F1 racing is because it was this girl I was interested in.
Dang.
And she loved F1 racing.
No way. What?
And I'm like, all right, I got to start watching F1.
Yeah.
So I did for a good year and a bit.
Whoa.
And I knew everyone. I knew the names. I knew the teams. I knew like the internal politics. I knew the rule change, like rule changes.
Yeah.
Whatever. All that stuff. It's as a result of a girl. Yeah, I'm a sham, man.
No, I was hoping then you'd tell me what happened with this girl.
Oh, okay.
Because...
I'm trying to figure out.
You watched F1 rating for a year, son. You better tell me what happened with this girl. And then I got really into F1 racing and forgot all about the girl. Now I'm in love with the motors.
All right. You know how you have these, you know, sometimes when you're a Muslim and you live in a you live in a place that doesn't have that many.
Right.
You fall into the I hope I can convert this one situation.
Yeah. That fantasy that we all.
Yep. Because then what you do is you gravitate towards that one time that you know there's one person that was able to do it. That means you should be able to do it too.
Yeah.
I'm pretty good. I know my religion pretty well.
Yeah.
I could act so prophetically
that
you'd be like, what is this light of a religion that you follow? And let me in.
And you like F1 too? Oh, okay, perfect.
So
I wasn't sure until you said you liked F1. What are the pillars?
It was one of those situations.
All right. So okay.
Yeah.
Well, fair enough.
And then eventually just it wasn't going to work out.
Yeah. So. No, that's, I know how that stuff goes. We all have had our F1 girl.
Yeah. So
we have. I had a theater girl.
You did?
Yeah, theater girl.
This is back in Texas, yeah?
Yeah. We're in theater here. Shit. But I got really into theater for a minute. You know, one semester of theater.
Yeah.
I was like, what am I doing? I went back to tennis.
Okay, fair enough. Did you go back to tennis as a result of the fact that it didn't work out?
I just realized that there's no point of converting girls in...
Shut up.
In Texas. Dude, it's just... There's so... 9/11 just happened. You just know...
It's such an uphill battle.
Yeah, you're like, right now is not the time to be converting girls.
The weird mental thing is that during the time that you're really interested in someone and you're trying to impress them...
Yeah.
And whatnot, and they're not Muslim, is that anytime that Muslims hit the news, you feel like you have to somehow throw into random conversation a clarification of it.
Yeah.
Right?
Exactly.
And so you're just talking about random stuff, and then all of a sudden you're like, oh, yeah, by the way, on the news, it's some really weird stuff, by the way, mm-hmm. and then you try to clarify.
Just, you know, jihad, it means struggle, you know? Like we say it all the time, like, oh, the homework's jihad, you know? Kimberly. Something like that. You know, in Texas, I didn't mind when people asked me religious questions that were racist.
Yeah.
I minded when they asked me shit like that. It's like, oh, you're Muslim? Is it true you guys drink your own pee? And you're just like, what stereotype? Like, where'd you even come up with this?
Oh, okay.
Like, what do you think of us that we drink pee? Like, is this something I'm supposed to know about?
You know what I'd be more pissed about? Is the fact if Oprah had some doctor come on and explain the benefits of drinking your own pee, people would be drinking pee.
It's right? True.
But just because...
Oh, yeah. That's true.
Right?
Since we do it. Like, oh.
There's definitely a freaking double standard here.
Yeah, there is.
Okay, I have an example of that.
Okay.
This is a question I had to field when I was in high school. Do you guys clean your butt by putting your finger in your butt?
That's a good question. I want to know how you answered this. I just had the visualization. And I can imagine you just looking at them like... For a second, I would wonder if I'm like, oh man, this guy's butt is way cleaner than mine. If that's how he's doing it, I never even thought about that.
Okay.
What did you say to him? I just can't imagine what he's been hearing to ask that question.
So apparently it was during religious, world religions. Mm-hmm. It was during world religions. After that, we had, because I was in French immersion, so we always have classes together for the most part. And it's like, excuse me, three people who were in that class, like they didn't even wait for the class to start. They like all came up to me and they had this burning question.
Right.
And this was the question.
Yeah.
And so I had to figure out what's the best way for me to answer this question. Sorry, man. I just got to do this real quick.
No problem.
So I figured I would choose just the way how they know how they clean their butt. I would go with the white standard.
Okay.
The white standard is tissue paper.
Yep.
And then I say, all right, so it's tissue paper and then sometimes water. Hmm. And then I just left it at that, which is pretty accurate. But the thing is that I feel like... If I went and said like, well, sometimes it's like a hose with a nozzle.
You lied to them.
And then there's a thing.
You told them just enough of what you were using. You just told them the materials. You didn't tell them anything. For all they know, you could take the nozzle off your butt. You didn't even tell them what you do with the nozzle or the tissue paper or the water. They don't know what you do with the water.
I felt like ambiguity would go for a long way.
You did the right thing. Because if you told them what you do.
Yeah.
It's one thing to like blow things up, but like that's even, they're never shaking your hand, you know? You're not getting handshakes for like a lifetime.
Mm-hmm.
That guy. You want to end the podcast there?
Just, that's how we do it.
That's how we do it.
No,
hope
I don't
you like
so.
What you washed. Just walk out of here.
I'm trying to think of another maybe a weird question that I got. I got another one recently. That was at work.
Okay.
Yeah.
So recent, that's...
The HR lady was asking me about hijab.
Okay. What'd you tell her? It's an important question.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
I said the general mandate.
What was the question instead of the answer?
Oh, no. Why did he wear a hijab?
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So I just said, explain the general mandate is to cover your hair as a result of the rulings in the Quran.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that there are stipulations on like a dress code for men as well, although much, much looser in ruling.
Okay.
And that was pretty much it.
Oh,
yeah.
I was hoping for something more exciting.
You try to avoid like a behavioral, because it'll turn into a behavioral question, mm-hmm. is essentially what that comes down to. Yeah. Because the question would be like, well, you know, why do women have to cover up and men don't? And, you know, why didn't men just lower their gaze,
right,
as opposed to women having to wear the hijab and also men lowering the gaze? So it's a bunch of that stuff. Then you start getting to a behavioral question, and then there's a lot of room for debate on that.
I was at the Blue Mosque, and there was a white lady there, and they wouldn't let her go into the prayer area because she has shorts on.
Okay.
And she would not understand because the guy was speaking in terrible English. Mm. As to what was happening, but there'd be dudes going in shorts that were covering their knees.
Yeah.
It was very, and then I had to pull the lady aside and kind of explain it.
Oh, thank you.
And then, but she was, you know what it is? It's not even what you're told. It's how you're told.
Yeah. Yeah.
The Arab guy was literally yelling at this woman to get out with her short shorts. Sure. Ah, out. He's screaming out in shorts over and over. But a lot of guys were in shorts.
She's like, it's out of season. It's out of style.
Out.
What part of it is out?
There are cats in there. They don't even have any clothes on, and mm-hmm. I can't wear shorts. That's my favorite part about Istanbul, is cats. But I digress.
Toxoplasma.
I don't know if that's real, man.
I think it's real. It's not real. It's not real.
It's a possibility.
Okay.
Here, listen. Toxoplasma, for those who don't know, it's something that... Well, how do you explain it since we've said it? We should touch on it a little bit.
I think it's a bacteria of sorts that affect the brains of rats.
Right.
And so it makes the rat sexually attracted to the urine of a cat.
Right.
And so they go and seek out cat urine.
Because that arouses them.
And where there is cat urine, there's often cats.
Mm-hmm.
And then they get jacked by cats.
And then the cat gets toxoplasma,
which then poops it out.
Right.
And then humans would get toxoplasma by touching cat
any
poop.
Any sort of contact will do it.
And a lot of soccer players have toxoplasma.
So we both heard about it the same way, probably from the Joe Rogan podcast. And he told me about this, like I'm saying, it's personally. Like, this was about 6 years or six, 7 years. Like, it's been a while since he's been talking about this. And he says it makes men irrational. X amount of men who die of motorcycle accidents have toxoplasma. Mm. It's just, I haven't heard anything about this from any legitimate sort of health thing since.
It might be a black helicopter type situation.
Yeah, some like, I don't know. I don't even know what to tell you. I'm just like, I think I would have heard it by now a little bit. It's chemtrails kind of stuff.
Yeah. Do you have any conspiracies that you're bouncing around right now?
I'm not a conspiracy kind of guy. Because my conspiracies, they're not... I'm like, yeah, that makes sense. That doesn't seem like a conspiracy. Like, Pizzagate kind of stuff doesn't make any sense to me. But, like, other things, they're like, oh, the government does this to do this. I'm like, yeah, the government would do this to do this. Or the corporations, you know, having... I remember when I was in middle school, it was like, oh, conspiracy theory, all these oil companies are working together to raise up prices. And, like, they have the same board members.
Yeah.
Exxon, Shell, like, these guys aren't competing. There's no conspiracy. Like, I was in middle school and I was like, look, this guy works for this guy and this guy. He must listen to what they tell him and then tell these guys so they all don't have to compete. I was like, in middle school, I'm like, yeah, there's no conspiracy.
But you're a very insightful young child. You knew not to convert someone before.
I tried once and then I realized you just can't. Yeah. It's just not worth it.
I fell for that shit.
It's like, hard, man.
Like 4 years.
Dude, it's
still fell for it.
I know. You just think, you know, you think you've improved. You feel like you understand your religion so well, and you love it.
Yeah.
And if you show somebody else, you know, it's like it's like anything else that you love dearly. Yeah. But when you love something as dearly as you love your religion, you just assume that if you like unfold it to somebody in a proper way, they'll love it too.
Yeah.
While they're like, I don't like the song. And you're like, this is the Quran. But it just comes down to, you know, who you are.
Okay. I know we just bounced back and forth, but just I want to do something on the conspiracy side.
Yeah.
Okay. So there's a documentary called 0 Days.
I haven't heard of this.
Okay. 0 Days is a documentary about a computer virus that was built specifically by United States and Israel, although both nations completely deny their involvement in this. This particular virus had a specific target. The target was for it to infiltrate the Iranian centrifuges in their nuclear plant.
Whoa.
Okay. So the way how, they have a uranium enrichment program. Mm-hmm. And what they do is that they have centrifuges that spins uranium of, I don't know, but it spins it at a certain RPM.
Okay.
Which allows it to do something. Mm-hmm. And then with that, they make bombs.
All right.
Okay. And it's got to spin at a very specific rate.
Okay.
And what the virus would do is that it would infiltrate the system. It would make the centrifuges spin at higher or lower RPMs, thereby causing resonance and then failing or then blowing up. But at the same time, would send back information to the computers that are monitoring the entire thing and say that everything's go okay. So everything's okay, no problems over here while shit's blowing up in the refinement section.
Oh man.
So that was the goal of the virus. Mm-hmm. The thing is that the virus, so any nuclear plant has something called an air gap. And okay. What an air gap is, all of the computers that are on the network within the nuclear plant has no digital connection to any outside network.
What?
It has to be completely sealed because you don't want someone hacking into your network.
Yeah, that makes sense, but it also will leave some issues on the table.
Well, let me just continue.
Yeah, right? Go ahead.
Has
this happened, though?
This has happened.
Well, tell me what I didn't know this happened.
I'm getting there. I said documentary, bro. I mean, implies it didn't happen. All right. So for them to jump the air gap, you would need to infiltrate the computers or infect the systems of computers of engineers that would, like, from outside, that would have to visit the plant. Mm-hmm. And so what they would do is that they would, operators from United States or Israel would target particular technicians that would have an appointment to go visit the plant to update hardware, software, stuff like that.
Yeah.
And they would infect their computer, their laptops. And so then when they go to visit the thing, they'll bring their laptop, they'll go over there, and once when they're there, they will do whatever, and then they'll take a USB, plug it into their computer, and then upload it into the closed network there. That's how they jump the air gap.
Oh, I see.
By physically infecting the computers
of the people going in and out. Oh, that's ingenious.
Now, here's the thing. The reason why they had to do all of this is because Iran was ramping up their nuclear program.
Yeah.
And Israel wasn't good with that because that president, I forgot his name, Obadiah-Bajojin.
Oh, Ahmadinejad.
Thank you. He was openly saying, we're going.
Yep.
We're going to do it. Yep. And so Israel said that we're going to declare war on Iran unless United States helps us out. And so this is how they helped. They made cyber warfare. They created a virus to specifically attack that. What's super interesting about it is that there's something called a PLC, which is a programmable logic controller. Probably a programmable logical computer. It's like a small little unit that you can control, like a motor or something, based on like whatever software that you update in this PLC.
Yeah.
My company sells those PLCs.
Oh,
the particular
man.
PLCs that they were attacking were Siemens PLCs, but Eaton has their own PLCs. I used to work for Moeller. Moeller has his PLCs as well. So like it was like I was looking at products that I know that I've looked at and had to cross reference to offer up whatever we want put for our own applications. It was that stuff that they infected for them to do that other thing.
Interesting documentary. What's this one called?
0 Days.
Where'd you see it?
I downloaded it.
Okay.
Yeah. So iTunes. Internet.
All right. Cool. Yeah. I think that's interesting. Okay. Yeah. That's way better than my shit. No wonder my shit was so simple to dismiss as a kid. I didn't know enough. I didn't watch any documentaries. So kudos.
What?
my shit about, like, you know, Exxon and stuff like that.
Oh, okay,
easier. This is way more complex than what I was even aware
of. I thought it was pretty interesting. Give it a shot, people. Watch that documentary. It was one of the better ones I've seen. And then I also wanted to talk about Snowden. You didn't get a, you didn't watch Snowden yet, right?
I saw 20 minutes so far.
Okay, that's all you need to see.
I love the acting.
Okay, that's exactly what I'm going to talk about.
All right, perfect.
Get out of my head.
Dude.
So you know how Snowden actually sounds like.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
How accurate?
Joseph Gordon-Levy is... that's a lot of commitment, man.
Holy crap.
He's really good. Also, the way he just, like, his pauses and stuff. Like, you could tell the guy studied the way that Snowden speaks. You don't have to do that. You don't have to. But it adds so much for me. Personally, I loved it. I thought it was awesome. I didn't watch the movie, though.
It wasn't just the fact that, you know, where you're saying his pauses and yeah, sort of like a speech pattern, but even his tonality, he sounds exactly like him, which is crazy. And I remember listening to a podcast with Joseph that he was saying how after he had done the movie 50-50, how he went to counseling because he was acting a part of a person who had cancer. And he felt it was important for him to go see a therapist after doing the acting so that he can kind of like reset his brain that he doesn't have cancer, because he believes that with the power of your brain, you could manifest cancer.
Right. That was on the Nerdist, wasn't it?
I think so.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That was a good, that was a good talk.
I feel like he's like a method actor, but he's not like pompous about it.
Yeah, no, he is. He's definitely a, you can tell with all of it. The ones where he's a, there's one where he's a tightrope walker.
Oh, I didn't see that yet.
Oh, check it out. He has like a European accent, like Swedish one. It's a hard accent to do. Yeah. He does it beautifully.
Yeah.
And he becomes this guy, because this guy is like, he walked between the World Trade Towers. No net. Right? So that's what the movie's about.
Wait, but is he attached to the rope?
I'm not telling you nothing. I'm just saying, watch the movie. It's out now. It's been out. So like you can, it's good. Okay. You can just check out the Rotten Tomatoes. I know you don't watch trailers. Respect that. But yeah, solid movie. Okay. Solid. And Joseph Gordon-Levy is one of those guys, like, I'm so glad. Like, we're going to get to see this guy, like, grow old. We're going to see him die.
Uh-huh.
It's going to be great. He's going to be around for the rest of our lives.
Oh, do we have enough time? Hold on. All right, I think we have a little bit of time.
Okay, what do we have time for?
Westworld, please.
Oh, are you done with it?
I'm done with it.
You're done with it?
I'm done with it, bro.
Finally, thank God. It's about time. Shit, all this time for me just saying, please watch this thing. Well, what you just saw it recently, I'm assuming.
Yes.
And you probably like cannonballed the whole thing, like saw it all within a 2 week span or something?
Yes.
What did you think instead of me telling you what I think?
Okay, so Westworld is HBO's newest offering of like their best. This is their pinnacle.
Right.
Right after Game of Thrones.
Set not too far in the future. Probably like, what would you say, like 20, 30 years in the future, maybe?
Yeah. So basically they build a park and they populate the park with robots that... are incredibly lifelike to the point that you can't tell whether or not they're fake.
Yeah.
You can go in there, spend a lot of money, go in there, and you can like go on an adventure, become a cowboy.
Follow a storyline.
Yep.
And this is like a full Western world where they have like, even the horses and the animals are animatronic. And they have cowboys, Indians, and all these preset things you can do, or you could do your own thing and see where the story takes you.
Right. It's essentially like a video. It's like an open-ended video game. So you can do that, which is essentially what I think the original idea of it, or you can go there and have sex with a bunch of robots and kill a lot of people if you want to do that, whatever you want to do, right? Because you pay a lot of money, you can go there.
You can't be harmed. Like the robots are programmed in a way that they can't harm you. You can do practically whatever you want.
Yep. Yep. Okay. First of all, the concept, apparently you were telling me that this is not a new concept. This is a concept that's been around for a bit.
Westworld was a book written in the 60s, I believe. It was also a movie that was made in the 80s.
Okay. But this show is like this reimagining of whatever those concepts were and then updating it for modern times.
Right.
Holy crap. It's amazing. Yeah. And this show does a job that, how do I explain this? Is in a way of, you know how Christopher Nolan does not pander to the dumb viewer. Like, I'm just going to tell a story. There's not going to be any exposition whatsoever. You just watch and you're just going to have to figure it out as we go. Yeah. That's Westworld.
You catch up.
Yep.
Yeah. Exactly. I'm not going to slow down. You catch up.
And you just need to sort of figure out the world at the pace that they want you to. and that's it. Yeah. And what's amazing is that there's only 10 episodes to it. And obviously, each one is like a freaking movie. They have incredible actors.
Yeah. Starting off from the first one, like Dolores's father having a conversation with Ford. Ford's character's name? Anthony Hopkins.
Anthony Hopkins, yeah.
Dude, Anthony Hopkins, and this came out of nowhere.
Yeah, yeah.
You were saying?
So, excellent cast. Excellent way to tell a story where you don't mind not understanding what's going on because of the caliber of acting and storytelling in front of you that you're like, okay, I'm okay with jumping in, like taking a leap of faith, just follow this story, just follow the show and just see where it takes you because it's like a visual, everything about it is just incredible. Yeah. So that being said, Anthony Hopkins is, we know he's amazing because we watch his stuff and we get a feeling, oh my God, this is really good. Yeah. This is really good. But it's like if you don't train in an art form, you don't understand the true beauty of it, right? So for example, for you know jiu-jitsu. So when you're watching it, you're seeing stuff I don't see, right? When I see a picture, I see things that you don't see.
Mm-hmm. I see a picture. You see everything that goes into taking the picture.
Exactly, lighting, whatever, framing. But with regards to, let's say for acting, neither one of us do acting. No. Neither one of us act. So all we can understand or we can appreciate it from a point of view of, I know I'm seeing something special, but I don't quite know why. Yeah. But that's the feeling that you'll get for the entire show, applied for everyone, for everything, for every scene, everything. There is a YouTuber called The Nerd Writer, and he breaks down one conversation that Anthony Hopkins has in the show. It's a 9-minute video, and he explains the incredible nuances of Anthony Hopkins as to what he brings to the table. Like, what does 40 years of acting at like this incredible peak performance every time that he does it.
Yeah.
What type of stuff does he bring to the table with that caliber, with that experience? I watched that. I'm like, okay, I'm gonna have to rewatch the entire show now.
I'm so happy you watched it.
Yeah.
Because I know you're one of those guys that always has like 6 shows on the go. So when somebody tells you to watch a show, I'm sure it was tough.
Something stopped, yeah.
Yeah. What was the big thing that made you, at what point did you say, oh, I'm going to have to watch the rest of this?
Okay. Excuse me.
Because the concept is interesting.
Right.
But they wrote it really well.
Yeah.
And it keeps your interest the whole time.
I'll be honest. At the beginning, I was slow on the uptake. Mm-hmm. So it was only Anthony Hopkins. Excuse me. It was only Anthony Hopkins that was kind of keeping me going. Mm-hmm. But what truly went, when it went from a regular show to an absolute amazing show, is the first major reveal.
Right.
So spoilers from on here on out.
We can't give spoilers for this show.
New,
right? Yeah.
It's too new. It's too new. Yeah, it's too new. It's
TV
too special.
Shows you can't give spoilers to.
Right. Okay. So the first reveal.
Yeah.
The first reveal. You know what I'm talking about. That's the one that really, I was like, okay, so what they're doing is that they're very meticulous on how they're telling the story. Mm-hmm. So it's one of those times where you're getting like things in the background are important. Yeah. Things that just happen for a split second and you don't see it, that's important. Like every sentence that someone says, every piece of dialogue, it will come into play. Mm-hmm. It's rewarding for someone who's paying attention to watch it. That's when that happened, I was like, oh, okay. And what's amazing is that even if you, now that you know and you're primed and you're ready and you're watching it, when you get to the second revealed, you're like, there's no way I could have seen this.
Yeah.
But then once when you get there, it explains like the 4 episodes before, you start understanding what the frick you were watching.
100%. Hey, if anybody's lost, it'll make perfect sense once you watch the show, because that's as good as you can explain it without ruining it for, and if you didn't understand it, you're welcome. That's as well as you can explain that shit.
Thanks.
But yeah.
No, very good recommendation, bro. How did you get through? How did you find out about it?
Bill Burr. Bill Burr was talking about it and how his wife, Nia, fiance, whatever,
yeah,
his soon-to-be baby mama, mm-hmm, Bill Burr's expecting.
Oh, yeah. Congratulations, Bill Burr.
Yeah, he's going to have so much new material about babies.
I'll send him a tweet.
He was saying that how he loves it, and his baby mama, Nia's black, and mm-hmm, she's like, Nia hates this show. Because every time the show comes on, she's like, black people were not cowboys. We weren't treated well. The show's... But he, like, loved it. Yeah. And I watched the first episode and the acting. It was just, like, there's a character named Dolores, mm-hmm, her father, mm-hmm, his acting alongside with Anthony Hopkins. I was like, yeah, the acting from the first show, mm-hmm, could at least get me to watch the first four episodes. And every episode, there was some reveals that were like, oh. And those things just built until the finale I really liked. A little disappointed, but I really liked it. I can't wait to see where it goes because... Yeah. Dude, this show, they wrote it really well where it carries the storyline perfectly. Like, economy of words is something you're really careful about when it comes to jokes. And it's like, they reveal just enough information that it's super interesting and it has this build up to the very end. So, I'm looking forward to, like, recommending it. I've seen the first episode four times because I'll have somebody open, like, just watch the first episode.
Just trying to, like, get them
hooked. I've seen it four times. Yeah. Anyways, I'm glad you snuck the conversation in there, though.
Yeah. Totally forgot. Should have been on the list. Yeah. All right, that's it. People, main takeaway, go watch Westworld. And Friday Night Lights. Trust me. It's like a good cry. It's a good cry. You won't cry.
That's not a good sell.
But it's a good cry.
Like, I don't want to cry about a coaching football movie.
Man, it makes you feel good. There's something special about
it. All right.
All right. I hope you guys like what you heard.